Welcome to yet again to Can You Believe It? We are privileged today and joined by a professor from Kenya, Dr. Teddy Njoroge Kamau. We're going to look into the issue that is so relevant, an issue that we all have to deal with, the issue of death. What happens immediately after we die? Dr. Kamau is going to address the issue from a biblical perspective. We'll keep out all the emotions and stick to the text. No personal opinions, but just deal with what does the scripture say when it comes to the issue of death. Dr. Kamau holds a doctorate in or doctorates in the areas of theology and philosophy, and is also a doctoral scholar in behavioral psychology. He has written a commentary in the book of Hebrews and holds seminars to opportunities to tr train and to teach pastors, and also holds conferences in Kenya to help pastors know how to expound and to ex to ex what is the word? Exegete God's word without error. Today, again, we address the issue that many of us will have to deal with at one time or another. Last time I checked, 100 out of 100 will all have to die. Some just go ahead of us or go just before we can be able to go. But at the end of the day, death is a crucial subject. What does the Bible have to tell us about this concept of death? Dr. Kamau, it's all yours. Take it.
Thank you so much, Dr. Onesimus. Pastor, thank you so much for again going across borders and connecting with me in this very, very important subject of death. But before I do that, what I would like you to do is to read for me the book of Genesis. Because everything in the Bible, every theology, every philosophy, every doctrine, every practice begins with Genesis chapter 1, chapter 2, and chapter 3. That's where we find the foundations of life, foundations of faith, foundations of understanding, foundations of teaching. Anything that we do, seen or unseen, begins with Genesis. So I'd like you to read the book of Genesis, chapter 3.
All right, you want me to read the entire?
I think we will start in verse, you want to start in verse 16?
All right, I can do that. 16. Okay. All right. Let me begin with 13, rather 12. To provide the context, the man said, "The woman you put here with me, she gave me some fruit from the tree, and I ate." Then the Lord God said to the woman, "What is this you have done?" The woman said, "The serpent deceived me, and I ate." So the Lord God said to the serpent, "Because you have done this, cursed are you above all livestock and all wild animals. You will crawl on your belly and you will eat dust all the days of your life. And I'll put enmity between you and the woman and between your offspring and ours. He will crush your head and you will strike his heel." Verse 16. To the woman he said, "I will make your pains in childbearing very severe. With painful labor you will give birth to children. Your desire will be for your husband and he will rule over you." To Adam he said, "Because you listened to your wife and ate fruit from the tree which about which I commanded you, you must not eat from it. Cursed is the ground because of you. Through painful toil you will eat food from it and all the days of your life. It will produce thorns and thistles for you, and you will eat the plants of the field. By the sweat of your brow you will eat your food until you return to the ground. Things from it you were taken, for dust you are, and to dust you will return." Adam named his wife Eve because she would become the mother of all living things.
Adam named his wife Eve, for she will become, says, the mother of all those who will live. I like this statement. The reason is because it makes us understand two things. One, all those who will enter heaven will be born of a woman. And all those who will enter into eternal damnation, they will be born of a woman. There is no escape. As long as you are born of a woman, you either enter into eternal domain of Jesus Christ, or you will end up in eternal damnation by Jesus Christ, and there is no escape. Okay,
say that again. There are two options. You get that.
Two options.
One.
All those who are born of a woman, they have two situations. One, they will either enter into the domain of Christ with him, or they will enter into the damnation by Christ for those who reject him. There is no other option for man.
Would that be based on John 3:16?
Whether we believe or don't believe, John 3:16 says, for God so loved the world that whosoever believes in him will not perish, but have everlasting life. That means if you do not believe, you will enter into eternal damnation. Both of these situations arise from Genesis. Why? Because man is created by God. And as we learned the other time, and I would like Dr. Joseph being there in the United States of America, I want him to read for me Colossians. Remember, we started Colossians again. We go back to Colossians. We were talking about when we were discussing the issue of authority, we were talking about Colossians. Everything starts with Genesis. And Paul has words that he speaks in Colossians chapter 1, verse 15 to 20. And you can go ahead.
The Son is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. For in him all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities. All things have been created through him and for him. He is before all things, and in him all things altogether. And he is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning and the firstborn from among the dead, so that in everything he might have the supremacy. For God was pleased to have all his fullness dwell in him.
Exactly. For God was pleased to have all, not half, all his fullness dwell in him. Mm-hmm. All right. So Paul says that all things were created through him, by him, and for him, belonging to him. Who is this? Jesus Christ. Who is Jesus Christ? The Son of God. Who is God? God the Father. And who is God the Father? He is the all in all. So he decides. In the throne of God, there is a decision made. God the Father, who is all in all, in his kingdom, decides, I'm going to give my Son, Jesus Christ, the full authority. Authority to do what? Jesus, in Matthew chapter 18, says, all authority has been given unto me.
Mm-hmm.
Paul continues from where Christ left, and he says, all authority, that authority that Jesus Christ is talking about, it is the authority that he was given by my Father. For what purpose? Genesis chapter 1. It says, and I'm going to read this, Genesis chapter 1. It says, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. So Paul is saying in the book of Colossians, I want you to go back and look at the book of Colossians chapter 1, verse 15 to 20. Paul says that all things were created by him, through him, and for him. Who?
Right.
Jesus Christ. Therefore, when I go back to Genesis, therefore, given that what Paul is saying is true, revealed to him by Christ and the Father, as Paul says, then when I go back to Genesis chapter 1 and I read, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth, that when I hear there, God mentioned. Me, I put this. This is what I usually say. In the beginning, Christ created the heavens and the earth. If you do not understand who is the source of all things by the authority of the Father, then you are going to miss everything about what we're talking about,
redemption,
death, resurrection, and eternal life. If you miss everything else, don't miss one thing. Paul says in the book of Colossians, again, chapter 1, verse 15 to 20, that all things are created by him, through him, and for him, whether principalities or powers or dominions or things. Okay, if that is true, and it is true, because Paul is speaking on behalf of Christ, okay, and Christ represents the Father, then Genesis chapter 1 is true when I read, and I read it this way. In the beginning, Christ created the heavens and the earth. All right? If you understand that, then you understand then why he is redeeming it. Okay?
Yeah.
Now, what we are talking about today is the consequences that are found in the book of Genesis. So, given that Christ is the one who creates all things, and together with the Father and the Holy Spirit says, let us make man in our own image, the presence of the Father and the Holy Spirit being there. And why is it important? Let me say this. This is one thing that people miss. Why is it important for Christ when it comes to the creation of man? He says, let us make man in our own image. It's because life comes from the Father.
Right.
Let me say that again. Christ creates the form that is man. Because the Bible says, since he is the one in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Since it is Christ who is creating, when it comes in the book of Genesis chapter 2, and Christ forms man from the ground, that which he has created, matter, soil, once he forms the man, where you look, the way I look, in the image of God, okay, who is going to breathe into man? God the Father. Because Christ himself is from the Father. That's a very important statement. So, Christ forms man, then the breath comes from God the Father, who is the source of life. So man becomes a living being. Since man is created by Christ for the purpose of Christ under the authority of God the Father has given then his breath to Christ so that it can be in every man. Let me say that again. The Father is the one who gives Christ the authority.
Right.
Christ does not do anything without the authority of the Father. And he says that. He says, I don't do anything that my Father doesn't allow me to do. Okay? He is given authority to create man.
Right.
Today we are talking about human life. We are talking about the beginning of human life and the end of human life. Human life, this flesh, this body that you see, is formed by Christ, but the breath that gives you life that makes you a living being, that one is a breath that God the Father comes and he puts into every human being. He comes and he gives him the breath of life. Okay? After that, Christ lays the rules and regulations. He says, listen, all these things are yours. Christ does not need mountains. He doesn't need a tree. He doesn't need fish. He doesn't need beef. There's nothing that Christ has created that he needs. He doesn't need it. The purpose, and the Bible says, the purpose of that creation, he says, you know what? Hey, listen. God the Father gave me, he asked me to create. Give me the authority. Say, hey, son, what do you want to do? I say, I want to create. He said, okay, well, create whatever you want to create. Then he creates. And then he says to man, listen, I am going to form you and I want you to be responsible on my behalf. I'm giving you authority. Again, the issue of authority is very important. God the Father gives authority to the son. The son gives authority to the man, gives him all the instructions that he needs in order for him to live in this beautiful, beautiful manifest of the ingenuity of the glory of God, this beautiful place where things just run.
Like the earth.
You know, these things just, I was watching the other day, Frontline, about the brain, and the doctors have come to the, you know, neurosurgeons and these neuroscientists, they have come to the conclusion that we are not in control, that we might think that we are in control of our lives, but then they say, this was very interesting paper that they made. I thought it was very interesting. They say, you know what, most of the stuff in our system, in our body, runs independent of us. Yeah. How many times do you stop in the day to, you know, to count whether you're breathing? Eh? Think I'm breathing. How many times do you even think about anything that you're doing, walking? You just wake up and you walk. You don't think about it. They say that it is independent. It seems as if these things are independent of us, but we believe that we are. And the pride of man, the hubris of Nebuchadnezzar, is for men to believe that they are in control of anything. We're not even in control of ourselves. We don't even know how we function. We are very complicated. It's a complex that was created by Christ. And not just that. This is the other thing. And there's a book, Dr. Joseph, I'm writing a book, and I hope it's going to be available. It's about the definition of good. When Christ said, after everything he said, it's good. What does that mean, it's good? Let me give you a hint of what good means. In 1911, Theodore Roosevelt sailed all the way from the United States, and he came to East Africa. By that time, it was under the British. He used those old ships to travel, took him forever. And to get back to the United States, where Dr. Joseph is, to get back to the United States, he took the Nile River. Took him forever. Theodore Roosevelt, after he retired, he came to East Africa. Okay? Now, that time, even then, there was oil. There was jet fuel, okay? There was material available to make the 777s, 747s, the A350, the 380, the A380s. The material was there. In fact, during that time, the idea of waves that create internet so that you can see me from a distance, it was there.
Only that.
It was there. It had not been discovered. So the stuff that is created by Christ for our benefit, he has made reservation for everything until the end of time. We will lack nothing. That's why I emphasize to Christian families to educate their children. Make sure your children go to school. They need to study biology. They need to study physics. They need chemistry. Emphasize education. You know why? The stuff that was created for us, this life in the beginning, he looked at it and he said, it is good. It is complete. But then this is what happens. Even though he gave us that complete life, Satan comes to the Garden of Eden. As I finish this first session so we can go to the next, this is what happens. Even though he has created everything that is needed, that is necessary, the complexity of life, the beauty. I love bananas. Kenya, we grow the best bananas. You know, we don't, they don't go to the refrigerator. They grow, we go to get them from a tree, and the sun makes them ripe. And when you imagine a banana, it's a good example of what we're talking about. The life that was taken away from us by the forces of darkness. A banana is so protected that you rip it open and you taste the banana, eat the banana, and there's this incredible taste. And you can distinguish between a banana and an orange. Let me say that again. As simple as that is, it's amazing. When you taste a banana and an orange and a pear and an apple, when you drink coffee, and when you drink Kenyan coffee, by the way, is the best. And tea, you grow tea in Kenya. The distinction, even milk, strawberries, pears, chicken. You can tell the difference between chicken and fish and beef. I'm just telling you about the basic things we take for granted, the life that was taken away, given to us by Christ in the beginning. His desire was for us to live this life. Imagine the background that you're looking, that Dr. Joseph has brought into our attention, the trees, the mountains, that we are able to distinguish between the clouds and the mountain, the green, the flowers. Because I love flower gardens. I love flowers. That we can, those things, they're so complex, but they give us incredible joy. Oh my goodness, when you're tired and you're thirsty and you get a glass of cold water, the experience of having that cold water, when it comes to your body, as simple as water is, the experience, that life that we were given, Satan comes, okay, and decides, you know what? I'm going to take it away from you through a lie. Because as we end the session to get into the next one, this is what happens. Satan, remember, comes and says to the woman, you were lied to. That the imagine the creator who gave you all these good things, he says, lied to you.
Right.
Follow me and I will give you better things. The question is, honestly speaking, what could be better than that which
God
Christ?
Well, with that subject of the fall, we're going to look a little bit deeper into how death comes into the picture. Where did death come from? How is this issue of death supposed to be looked at and perceived in our world today? Again, we're going to base our the teachings and our conclusions on scripture. Nothing emotional, nothing out of words of wisdom and philosophies of this world, but exactly what the scripture says. This is, can you believe it? Well, believe that all truth is God's truth, and our job is to find it and to share it with all humans, big and small, in God's green earth. Welcome to our episode number 2, as we continue to explore the subject of where did death come from and what happens immediately after you die. Thank you.